And welcome back. We'll talk about X-ray. This video will include about the spectra and diffraction of X-ray. Before we talk about the X-ray spectra, we shall roughly understand how is the X-ray produced. It is quite similar with the cathode ray production, which you have learned in semester 2. It starts with thermionic emission to produce free electron, then accelerated by high potential difference. From here, it involves the conversion of electric potential energy to kinetic energy of the electron. Next, the electron will collide with target atoms such as tungsten or whatever it is to produce the photon, which has the wavelength in the range of X-ray. The energy conversion here has very low efficiency, which is about 1%, and most of the energy actually converted into heat energy. Therefore, the target atom material usually has very high melting point to make sure it doesn't melt during the process. Now we will discuss about the spectra. As you can see on the right, there are three things we can take note. First is the continuous spectrum, where the intensity of the X-ray varies smoothly with the wavelength. This is due to the loss in kinetic energy of the electron when they collide with the target atom. The loss in kinetic energy has a range of value, is converted to photon as what I've explained just now. The second thing here is about the existence of minimum wavelength. We can see there's minimum value of wavelength obtained during the process, and this reflects to one type of collision where all the kinetic energy of electron is converted to photon in a single collision. What we should mention in a single collision is that the electron may collide a few times before it runs out of kinetic energy. So the minimum wavelength is when all the kinetic energy is converted at once. However, you could see that the intensity is low, which means that this type of collision has very low probability to occur. From here, we also can derive the expression of minimum wavelength based on energy conversion from electric potential energy to kinetic energy, then to photon energy. We can take EV equal to hc over lambda, rearrange the equation, we can obtain the minimum wavelength in terms of potential difference, which is equal to hc over EV. Based on the equation, we can see how the potential difference affects the range of wavelength photon produced, where we can get lower value of minimum wavelength when we increase the potential difference. Next, we shall discuss the third thing about X-ray spectra, which is the characteristic line spectrum. You can see there are a few peaks in the graph, which shows that there is a high chance that the X-ray with that certain wavelength produced in the process. So the term characteristic reflects that the wavelength is actually unique based on the type of target atom. So this is why X-ray is often used to study about the structure of crystalline material. Back to the main topic, loss wavelength of X-ray is produced starting with the phenomenon where the fast-moving electron will knock out the electron of inner shell of the atom. There is a vacancy when the electron is knocked away, so the electron from outer shell flew in the space and emit a photon with specific wavelength. The concept is quite similar to what we have discussed before in the atomic structure. The wavelength produced can be calculated using the same formula, which is the difference in energy level equal to hc over lambda. And there's also one similar thing here. The emission of photon can be categorized into two series, which include the K and L series. K series are the photon produced when the vacancy in the innermost shell, or also known as L shell, are filled by the electron from outer shell. For L series, it is for the second shell, or also known as M shell. Before we move on, let's discuss a few questions from past year in 2018. We are given with the potential difference of 20 kilovolts to produce X-ray. Now, the question doesn't mention about energy loss, so usually we just consider it as 100% energy conversion unless we are given with certain information about it. We'll just quickly go through the question. First is to determine the final speed of electron, and we have learned about the energy conversion. For this question, we can consider the electric potential energy convert to the kinetic energy. Next is about the minimum wavelength, which is exactly what we have discussed. The electric potential energy is converted to the photon energy. Last is the de Broglie wavelength. If you don't remember the formula, you should at least remember the derivation by taking the Einstein equation E equal to mc squared equal to hc over lambda. So notice the velocity here should refer to the velocity of electron in this case, not the velocity of the photon. We shall discuss the last topic in this chapter, which is the X-ray diffraction. So X-ray has a very short wavelength, which is not easy to be diffracted. We will use a regular crystal which is made of parallel atomic planes that has very small spacing to diffract the X-ray. Basically, the X-ray will be reflected by the atomic planes at a certain angle, which is known as glancing angle or Bragg angle. So you may refer back what you have learned about optical path difference and also constructive interference before. The diffraction pattern can be produced when the reflected X-ray interferes constructively. So the optical path difference is integer multiple of wavelength, which can be expressed as 2d sine theta equal to m lambda. where D is the spacing between two atomic planes and M is the order of diffraction. Let's continue the past year question in 2018. We are given with the wavelength of X-ray, the first order of diffraction is observed at a glancing angle of 12 degrees. First question, determine the energy of X-ray photon, which is not a problem for you. Just use the equation of hc over lambda, where the velocity this time is the velocity of photon 3 times 10 to the power of 8 meter per second. Next is the spacing between atomic plane. Just apply the Bragg equation and you can get the answer here. To discuss further about this diffraction, we also came across with the maximum order of diffraction before. The condition is that the value of sine theta cannot be more than 1. Put in the formula and rearrange it, the order should be not more than 2d over lambda. From the calculation, the highest order here will be 4 in this case. There is also a similar question you may try, which is in the STPM Past Year in 2019. And also, I found a good question from the trial paper of Victoria Institution in 2021. I would suggest you to read about it to strengthen your understanding on the X-ray phenomenon. So that's all for my discussion today. If you still have any question, leave it in the comment section below. Thank you.